Hi everybody. In earlier videos, we've applied the Schrodinger equation to different types of motion of atoms, translational, vibrational, and rotational. In this video, we'll apply the Schrodinger equation to the structure of a hydrogen atom itself to look at the orbitals and energies of an electron. First, I'd just like to remind us of some of the historical context of this. As we said in the first couple videos of this course, the emission spectra of atoms were one of the experimental observations that led to the development of quantum mechanics. In the late 1800s, Rydberg noticed a mathematical relationship in the bands of a hydrogen emission spectrum, and that mathematical relationship is shown here. The energy difference between two energy levels is equal to an experimental constant, which is now called the Rydberg constant, times 1 over the quantum number of each energy level squared. At the time, this was just an experimental observation. It was sort of rationalized with the Bohr model of the atom by saying that these electrons were in quantized orbits, but still, the fundamental physics wasn't known. It was the ability of the Schrodinger equation to explain these energy levels that was really the first major success of quantum mechanics, and that's what we'll be talking about in this video. Anytime we want to use the Schrodinger equation, we have to first think about what the Hamiltonian operator looks like. In this video, we're looking at what we call hydrogenic atoms and ions. And by that, I mean atoms and ions with one electron. So this could be a hydrogen atom, or it could be a helium plus ion, or a lithium 2 plus ion, etc. A hydrogenic atom or ion consists of one electron that has a mass me and a charge that we'll call negative e, and a nucleus that has a much heavier mass that we'll call mn, and a positive charge, ze, where Z is the atomic number of the nucleus. We know that the Hamiltonian operator is typically a sum of kinetic and potential energy terms, and that's true in this case as well. So let's think about what terms the Hamiltonian operator must include. There are two particles, an electron and a nucleus, and there must be kinetic energy terms related to both of those, and also a potential energy term that captures the attraction between the electron and the nucleus. If you've taken some physics, you may be able to guess where that potential energy term is going to come from. It comes from Coulomb's law. Coulomb's law tells us what the potential energy is when charged particles interact. So let's write out each of these terms. The kinetic energy terms look pretty much the same as they have in the past. Negative h bar squared over 2 times the mass of the particle times the Laplacian operator. We have one of these terms for the electron and one of these terms for the nucleus. And the potential energy operator is just the potential energy from Coulomb's law. The product of the two charges, so in this case negative E times positive ZE, which gives us a minus ZE squared, over 4 pi epsilon naught, which is the permittivity of free space, times the distance between the two particles. So this is what our Hamiltonian operator looks like for a hydrogenic atom or ion. There are a couple of things that we can do to simplify this Hamiltonian. First, as we did when we considered vibrational and rotational motion of diatomic molecules, we can treat this two-particle problem as a one-body problem if we consider the relative motion between the particles. If we do this, we're left with just one kinetic energy term, in which the mass that we're concerned with is the reduced mass of the nucleus and the electron together. Also, think about the types of particles that we're dealing with. Even in a hydrogen atom, in which the nucleus is just one proton, the nucleus is still more than 1,000 times heavier than the electron. We've seen that when we have two particles with very different masses, the reduced mass is very close to the mass of the smaller particle. So in the case of a hydrogenic atom or ion, it's fair to approximate the reduced mass as the mass of the electron. In other words, the problem that we're going to solve basically boils down to a very small particle, the electron, moving around what can be thought of as an infinitely heavy and stationary nucleus. While we're thinking about the terms of the Hamiltonian, I want to ask one more question. Why do you think we're only considering one electron atoms and ions to start? In other words, why do you think this problem would get much more complicated if we had more than one electron? I'll give you a few seconds to think about that. The answer is that the more particles we add, the more potential energy terms we add. If we had two electrons, we would not only need potential energy terms between the nucleus and each electron, we would also need a potential energy term that represents the repulsion between the two electrons. And it turns out that electron-electron repulsion makes things much more complicated. In future videos, we'll talk about how to approximately solve the Schrodinger equation with electron-electron repulsion, but it turns out it's not even possible to exactly solve the Schrodinger equation when there's more than one electron. Even for a hydrogen atom, the Schrodinger equation is not easy to solve, but we've been building up to it for a few lessons now. In the video about rotational motion, we found the wave functions for a particle on a ring of constant potential energy. We then used that to build up to solutions for a particle on a spherical shell, where we found that those wave functions are called the spherical harmonic functions, and they're products of functions in theta and phi. For a hydrogen atom, the wave function is in three dimensions, not only theta and phi, but also a radius r. It turns out that all the work that we've done so far will be helpful, because the wave functions for a hydrogen atom can be separated into the product of a radial wave function and an angular wave function. And the angular functions turn out to be exactly the same as the spherical harmonics that we found for a particle on a spherical shell. The goal of this video is not to derive every single step of the solution to the Schrodinger equation for a hydrogen atom. As chemists, what's more important is that we have an understanding of how to set up the problem and a qualitative understanding of how the solutions turn out. So on the next slide, we'll very quickly outline a lot of steps of math, but don't be too concerned if you can't follow every step. Having already thought about what terms are in the Hamiltonian operator, we can write out the Schrodinger equation like this. Next, we can write out the Laplacian operator in spherical coordinates. As you can see, the Laplacian operator looks pretty ugly. But the idea is that we can start to separate the terms in R from the terms in theta and phi. Next, we multiply both sides of the equation by 2 mu r squared. And again, the idea is that we're separating terms in R from terms in theta and phi. Next, we do something similar to what we did for a particle in a two-dimensional box. We assume that the wave functions can be expressed as the product of a function in R and a function in the angles. Then, for every place in the equation where we see psi, we can replace it with capital R times capital Y. And finally, we divide both sides of the equation by capital R times capital Y. Notice what this leaves us with. We have an equation that says that the sum of two terms is equal to zero. And if we look carefully at those terms, we see that the first one only depends on R. Theta and phi don't appear anywhere in that first term. And the second term only has the angles theta and phi, and it doesn't have r anywhere in it. So this equation says that a term that only depends on r, plus a term that only depends on theta and phi, is equal to zero, which is a constant. You may remember that we used similar logic for a particle in a two-dimensional box. And we concluded that the only way that this equation can be true for all values of r, theta, and phi is if each of these terms is individually equal to a constant. So, we've effectively separated this differential equation, which has three variables in it, into an equation that only depends on R and an equation that only depends on angles. Each of these equations is still fairly difficult to solve in its own right, but it's much easier to solve equations in terms of one or two variables than three. We'll let the mathematicians take it from there. Most of us don't have the background, or honestly any good reason, to solve those two differential equations ourselves. As we said, it turns out that the hydrogen wave functions are a product of a radial wave function and an angular wave function. The angular wave functions, which we'll call y of theta and phi, are the same spherical harmonic functions that we've already seen before for a particle on a spherical shell. Each of those spherical harmonics has two quantum numbers, L and M sub L. And if you'd like to remind yourself of what those functions look like, you can refer back to the video on rotational motion. The radial wave functions are functions that we haven't seen yet. Each radial wave function has two quantum numbers, n and l, and is the product of three terms, in addition to a normalization constant. The first term is a power, r to the l. The second is a decaying exponential, e to the negative r over n a naught, where a naught is a constant, the Bohr radius. And the third term is one of a set of polynomials, capital L of 2r over n a naught. Those polynomials can be looked up in a table in the textbook, and we'll talk about a couple important features of them in the next two slides. These quantum numbers n and l may look familiar from general chemistry. As you may remember, n can take on any positive integer value, 1, 2, 3, etc., and l can be any integer ranging from 0 to n minus 1. Let's think a little bit more about what the radial parts of these wave functions look like. For small values of r, places close to the nucleus, the r to the l term dominates. If l equals 0, this term goes to 1, and if l equals anything larger than 0, then this term goes to 0. So the r to the l term determines whether there's any chance that the electron will be found very close to the nucleus. Far from the nucleus, for large values of r, it's the decaying exponential term that dominates. When r gets large, e to the negative r over n a naught approaches e to the negative infinity, which is 0. So the decaying exponential term ensures that the wave function goes to 0 as we get very far away from the nucleus. And at intermediate values of r, not too close or not too far from the nucleus, it's the polynomial capital L that determines the nodal structure. Again, these capital L functions are just a set of polynomials. There's nothing special about them, and you can look them up in the textbook. Like many of the polynomials that we've seen in this class, they're named after a French mathematician. They're called the associated Laguerre polynomials. I've plotted a few of the radial wave functions on this slide, corresponding to different values of n and l. When I refer to a function with two numbers after it, those two numbers are the values of n and l. So, for example, r20 refers to the radial wave function where n equals 2 and l equals 0. There are a couple of things that are worth noticing about these radial wave functions. First of all, they vary in their number of nodes. You can see that r10 and r21 each do not have radial nodes, while r20 does have a radial node. It turns out that in general, the number of radial nodes in a wave function is n minus l minus 1. Also, notice the value of these functions where lowercase r equals 0. When l equals 0, which in the language of chemists refers to s orbitals, the value of these wave functions is non-zero at the nucleus. But when l is anything larger than 0, so p orbitals or d orbitals, etc., the value of the wave function is 0 at the nucleus. Let's briefly summarize all of the quantum numbers in a hydrogen wave function. The radial part has quantum numbers n and l, and the angular part has quantum numbers l and m sub l. So in total, an atomic orbital is a function with three quantum numbers, n, l, and m sub l. You may remember from general chemistry that there's actually a fourth quantum number, the spin quantum number, that we haven't gotten to yet, but we'll see that a couple of videos forward. We can think qualitatively about the effect that each of these quantum numbers has on an orbital. Roughly speaking, the quantum number n, which is called the principal quantum number, relates to the size and energy of the orbital. The larger the value of n, the larger the size and the higher the energy. The quantum number l, which is called the angular momentum quantum number, relates to the shape of the orbital. In the language of chemistry, this is what determines whether something is an s orbital or a p orbital or a d orbital. Formally, m sub l refers to the z component of the angular momentum of an orbital, but we can think of it as relating to the orientation of the orbital in space. As you've probably seen in general chemistry, each value of L corresponds to an orbital name. If L equals 0, we're talking about an S orbital. If L equals 1, it's a P orbital, 2 is a D orbital, and 3 is an F orbital. So, for example, if we want to refer to a wave function that has N equals 3 and L equals 1, we can refer to that as a 3P orbital. So far, we've looked at the wave functions of a hydrogen atom, but not their energies, the corresponding eigenvalues in the Schrodinger equation. For hydrogenic atoms and ions, the orbital energies take on the form shown on the slide, and they depend only on n. As you can see, the energy corresponding to a value of n is a negative collection of constants times z squared, where z is the atomic number, over n squared. Notice that this matches up with what was already known experimentally at the time. The Rydberg constant had already been measured. And now the Schrodinger equation could be used to find what the Rydberg constant is actually equal to in terms of fundamental constants. This was the first major success of quantum mechanics, that the Schrodinger equation led to a solution that was consistent with the measured energies in the emission spectrum of a hydrogen atom. Notice that because the Schrodinger equation says that the orbital energies in a hydrogen atom only depend on n, the implication is that the energies of some orbitals are the same. They're degenerate. The orbital with n equals 1 has the lowest energy. All of the orbitals with n equals 2 have the same energy as each other. All of the orbitals with n equals 3 have the same energy as each other, etc. This idea that orbital energy only depends on n is only true for hydrogenic atoms and ions. We'll see a couple of videos forward that in multi-electron atoms, orbital energy depends on both n and l. Just to make sure we're all on the same page, I'd like you to take a few seconds to think about this question. What are the possible sets of quantum numbers, n, l, and m sub l, of a 3D orbital? By definition, a 3D orbital has n equals 3 and l equals 2. And if you remember the restrictions on the values of m sub l in the spherical harmonic functions, m sub l can only range from negative l to l, so m sub l must be negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, or 2. The last thing I'd like to mention is the idea of ionization energy, the amount of energy that's required to remove an electron from an atom or ion. We can use the energy levels of a hydrogenic atom or ion to find the ionization energy. First, we need to decide, when an electron is removed from an atom or ion, from what value of n to what value of n does it go? If the electron is in its ground state, which it typically is, it starts in n equals 1. And if we want to kick it entirely out of the atom or ion, we're essentially exciting it to n equals infinity. So, we just need to figure out the energy difference between n equals 1 and n equals infinity. At n equals 1, the electron has the energy negative Rydberg constant times z squared, and at n equals infinity, the electron has energy 0. So the difference in energy should be Rydberg constant times z squared. So let's answer one final question. How many times larger is the ionization energy of a helium plus cation than the ionization energy of a hydrogen atom? We just said that the ionization energy of a hydrogenic species is the Rydberg constant times z squared. So for a hydrogen atom, it's the Rydberg constant, and for a helium plus cation, it's 4 times the Rydberg constant. So hopefully you said that it takes 4 times as much energy to remove an electron from helium plus as hydrogen. That's all for now. In the next video, we'll continue to think about the qualitative features of hydrogen orbitals.